Welcome to Sunday Father's Day. My name is Brittany, and I'm a part of the announcements team. Did you want to know a fun fact? Well, I'm going to tell you anyway. Did you know that it takes twice as long to pick up baseballs in the batting cage? Why? Because everybody thinks that they're Kobe. Well, I do have some few announcements for you. Roll the clip. That is all the announcements we have for you. If you missed any, no worries. You can check us out on our website, on our app, on our social media platforms, or even at the Connect table in the foyer. Well, dads, today is all about you. So here is a video dedicated to you.
Gentlemen, welcome to another dad battle. Now, is anybody, and I mean anybody at all, willing to face our champion?
Nope. Gentlemen, my son joined the golf team at school, so I bought him an extra pair of socks. In case he gets a hole in one.
Hole in one.
His dad jokes are so effortless.
See that? That's why he's the champ.
That's nothing. The other day, my daughter said a good Christian dad would buy her a car. So I said, well, a good Christian kid would walk, because that's what Jesus did.
Fathers!
We have a dad off.
Yeah!
Let's go!
Bring the noise!
Listen up, son. Just because God picked your nose doesn't mean you should.
When you start paying the bills, you can make some of the rules.
Come on!
Yeah. Hold up! Who touched the thermostat?
Yeah!
That lawn isn't gonna mow itself.
Let me stop what I'm doing and fix your boredom.
Hi, Hungry. I'm Dad.
I love the smell of Home Depot in the morning.
Yeah. Just wait till your mother gets home.
What? Pull my finger. Oh.
Get in there. Get in there.
You got this.
Come on, champ.
Nah. Just rub some dirt on it.
Hey!
I'm proud of you.
You can do hard things.
I love you, no matter what.
When God made you, he made something very special.
The proudest day of my life is the day you made me a father.
I thank God for you every time I get on my knees and pray.
And again.
Who gives this woman?
No,
you look at me. You look at me. Who gives this woman to be married to this man?
Her mother and I do.
Shout out to all the dads out there. Just want to thank you from the bottom of our hearts for being a hard worker, a protector, for leading the family, but most of all, for being the man that God called you to be. We love you so, so much. Now, if everyone could get up on their feet. No, you're not going home yet, because we still have a good word and worship. So get ready to rumble virtually in 3, 2, 1. Ding, yeah! Ding, ding, ding. What's up, y'all?
Hey, happy Father's Day to all you fathers out there, man. We love you. We're going to celebrate you today. But right now, we're going to celebrate our one and only Father that has made us, that has breathed his breath of life in us, that has picked us up, turned us around, placed my feet on solid ground. Come on, if you're alive and well in this place because of the Lord, can you just worship him in right now? Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Join me as I pray. Father God, we thank you, Lord, for today, Father God, especially for our fathers in this room, Lord. We come to worship you, though, Father God. We come to praise your name, Lord. We thank you for being our ultimate Father who has paved the way, who has guided us, who has loved us, who has showed us his mercy and his grace. Father God, be pleased with everything that is done today, oh God. We thank you. We love you. In Jesus' name, we all say amen. Come on, we're going to worship him. Let's put our hands up. Hey, in the back, put your hands up. Yeah. Yeah. Come on, if you know it, sing it out with me. Hey, because I was lost with a broken heart. All right. You picked me up, now I'm set apart. From the ash, I am born again. Forever safe in the Savior's hands. Come on. You were more than my words could say. I'll follow you, love, for all my days. Fix my eyes, follow in your ways. Forever free in unending grace.
Cause you are,
come on, you know it.
My
I hear
freedom.
You.
Hey. We lift you higher. Hey. We lift you higher.
Your love, never ending. Oh, oh, oh. You are alive in us. Nothing can take your place.
Come on, you're all we need, God.
You are all we need. Your love has set us free. Whoa, whoa.
Come on, if he set you free today to make you alive and well, sing this out.
Whoa, whoa.
Father God, we come to worship you and you alone, oh God. So help us sing this in the midst.
In the midst of the darkest night.
Hey. Let your love be the shine. You're breaking chains.
Breaking chains, I will hold you.
Come on, and you set your son.
Set your son down to set me free.
Everything.
Everything of this world.
Hey, I'm pressing on, Lord.
I'm pressing on till I see.
Come on.
Face.
Hallelujah.
Shout it out louder than before. Let the whole earth sing. Congregation, let me hear you. Hallelujah. It's a song. A song. Let the whole earth sing. Yeah. I don't know, y'all ready? I don't know, y'all ready? Down, set, one, two. The name of Jesus it is at the name of Jesus demons tremble. It is at the name of Jesus that dried bones are brought back to life. Come on, don't act like y'all don't got a testimony to share. It is at the name of Jesus why we are standing here today. I don't know about y'all, but he has definitely done a lot for me. And because of him, I am here today. I am standing and walking in the authority that he has given me, not what my past has called me to be. He even says it in his word, church. You are fearfully and wonderfully made in his image. So today, I want to encourage you all to sing this song over your life, over your home, over your family, over your children.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus.
Come on, church, your name is power.
Your name is power.
And your name is healing.
Your name is healing. Your name is love.
And it breaks every stronghold.
Break every stronghold.
Shine through the shadows.
Just want to speak the name. Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness for every enemy, and Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name. Church, he does not want us to live in fear. Tell somebody about the name of Jesus. Everything that you've all gone through, it's for a reason. It's to glorify him. Walk out in your purpose. Shout Jesus in the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, and Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus, shout Jesus,
shout Jesus from the mountains, and Jesus in the streets.
Father, thank you, Lord. Lord, we thank you that we can stand on you for a firm foundation, Father God. We thank you for the seasons that we go through, Lord. We thank you for your son, Father God, that you have given us the ultimate sacrifice. He didn't have to, Lord. He did not have to, but he did. So, Lord, today, we just want to honor you. We thank you and we love you, Father God.
We pray a special anointing over your speaker today, Lord. We pray and ask that you cover him from the top of his head to the soles of his feet, Father God. We pray and ask that you soften our hearts so we can receive what you have in store for us, Father God. Lord, we pray and ask that you continuously use him as a vessel, Father God. We pray and ask that you be with your children, Lord, those who couldn't be here today, those who are online, Father. We pray and ask for a special covering over them as well, Lord. Holy Spirit, we ask that you continuously be here with us. We ask that you continuously go before us, Father God. Lord, we ask that you have your way. In Jesus' mighty and matchless name we pray. Amen.
Amen, amen, and amen. Thank you so much, worship team, for bringing us in the presence of the Lord. Welcome, welcome, everybody. Good morning, New Hope Las Vegas. Welcome to those in the congregation today, and for those of you online. All right, guys, just wanted to say, Happy Father's Day! Woo! Thank you so much, fathers, for being the leaders in your home and leaders in this church. It is through you generations will be touched. So at this time, I'd like to call the ushers forward to collect our tithes and offering. And for those of you that like to do it digitally, on your pamphlet, there's a QRS code now. So you could take a snap of that and give that way, or on our application, NHLV, or you can go online and do that way as well. In the pockets in front of you, there's also our little booklets if you guys do want to give by cash or by check. And for those of you online, we also have a link that should have been dropped. Go ahead and click on there and partake in giving to the kingdom of God. So guys, I have a few announcements, all right? And let's start off first by thanking all the blood donators that came out last week. Give a hand clap. Thank you all so much. Guys, last Sunday, we had 15 newcomers that gave blood. Hallelujah for that. Overall, we had 46 blood donations. And that's going to impact 129 lives, guys. Thank you so much. If you didn't have an opportunity to give or you would like to give blood again, guess what? Blood drive is coming back October 2nd. You don't have to wait to sign up. So go on and register online right now or talk to anybody from our missions team and they'll go ahead and get you signed up. Thank you again and we hope to see you next time at that blood drive. I'll see you there. Secondly, speaking of giving to our community, NHLV Spirit of Kindness. We do community outreaches, guys. This happens every second and third Saturday of the month, all right? We meet at Las Vegas Rescue Mission. And so what they do is they help to give dinner for those of our homeless community. And they also, if you guys have anything to donate, old clothes, old socks, we take into that. And we also give in that way, and we also offer prayer. And with that, this past month alone, we had 31 volunteers, all right? And that fed 637 homeless people that were in need. 40 of them were prayed over. 3 of them accepted Christ into their life, salvation, hallelujah. And we even got to offer prayer for healing. So guys, come out. Be a part of what this church does, not only in-house, but out this house. You know what I'm saying? So be there, guys. Registration is required. So again, please go online or in our app. So next month, it's happening July 9th and July 16th. Sign up, show up. You know what I'm saying? Speaking of that, last thing to sign up for. We've been talking about it. RIM Youth Camp. Woo! We've been talking about it for a few months now, but time is running thin. June 25th, registration ends. So it's time to just sign up, guys. If you really feel the Lord wants to touch your middle schooler, your high schooler through this camp, trust and believe it will happen. Guys, don't worry about the money. Who knows that our Heavenly Father got a bank that's unlimited? Amen to that. So sign up and watch as God touches you and your household through this camp, all right? Woo! So at this time, I'm going to call the ushers forward as we pray for our tithes and offerings. as a congregation and our family, could you please close your eyes, bow your head, and stretch forth your hands and your heart as we feed into the kingdom of God. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for the opportunity that we can sow into your kingdom, Father God. Thank you for the seeds that are planted and the fruits that come forth from the money that we've given, Lord. More than that, Lord God, let it cultivate a heart of giving, because you love a cheerful giver, Lord God. I pray, Lord, whatever this is used for, Lord God, it will be felt not only in this church, but also in this city, Father God, also in this world, Lord God, whether it be chairs, whether it be feeding the homeless, Lord God, whether it be giving to people in Ukraine, Lord God, we just pray that this touches lives for you, Lord. Thank you for the jobs that you have given us, for you are our provider, Lord God. And this 10% is nothing, Lord. It is nothing, Lord, because we want to really give all. Let this just be a part of our 100% that we're giving, Lord. May it be to your glory. We love you, Lord. We honor you. In Jesus' mighty and matchless name, we say amen and amen. Woo! At this time, if you please stand to your feet as we welcome the quarterback for Christ, Pastor Austin Tialavea.
Thank you, Sister Poole. Hallelujah. God is good. God is good. All the time. All the time. Somebody give God the praise in his house. Come on, come on, come on. Somebody give God the praise in his house. Amen, amen, amen. What's up, New Hope Las Vegas? Welcome. Thank you so much for joining us. Those online, welcome as well. Since we're already standing, let's go ahead and declare our faith together as a church family. On a count of three, ready? One, two, three. God is who he says he is. God can do what he says he can do. I am who God says I am. I can do all things through Christ, and God's word is alive and active in me. Amen. Hallelujah. Welcome to the house of God. Thank you, worship team. You guys ready for a word today? You guys ready for a word today? I got good news and I got bad news. Bad news is I don't have a word for you. Good news, Holy Spirit does. So join me as we pray. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity that we get to draw closer to you today. Father, we pray that you increase as I decrease. We want to hear from your word and from your mouth. So Lord, use me as your conduit, as your vessel. We thank you, Lord. We give you the praise and all the glory. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. 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 Happy Father's Day. Happy Father's Day to all the dads in the house. Happy Father's Day to you, those of you online. If you're online tuning in with us, let us know what's on the menu for Father's Day, because we want to grub at your house. Well, happy Father's Day. Welcome, New Hope, Las Vegas. Isn't it kind of a chilly morning? It was kind of a chilly morning today, huh, in Las Vegas. On my drive here, man, it was a little windy. It was actually pretty nice. All right, it's June right now, but it's normally hot. But today it was a little cool, it was a little chilly, it was different. You know, it reminded me of one time, it was pretty cold in the wintertime, and my wife and I was like, hey, let's just crank up the heat in the house. So we turned on the heater, we turned it up, and I remember that night going to sleep. I don't know about you, but anybody in here hot sleepers? Yeah, man, I woke up in the middle of the night just like I was irritated, I was mad, sweaty, sticky, like I was like, I was irritated. I didn't like it. I was like, why is the house so hot? Why does it feel like it's hell in here? Right? I got up and I went to go check the thermostat, and it was on heat, and it was on one of those high numbers. It was super hot. Like, oh, I was so mad. I was so irritated. But I forgot I'm the one who set the temperature. I'm the one who set the thermostat. Isn't that just like us? As fathers, you can't complain about the heat in your home if you're the one who set it. You can't complain about the culture in your kingdom if you're the one who created it. Right? And that's the first bullet point for today. We're going right into the message. First bullet point for today is the culture of a kingdom is determined by the character of its king. The culture of a kingdom is determined by the character of its king. What kind of culture are we cultivating in our homes, dads? What kind of culture are we creating or cultivating in our own homes, dads? We can't complain about the culture if we set the culture. You can't complain about the kids talking back if you talking back to God. You can't complain about the kids cussing up a storm if you cussing up a storm. You can't complain about the kids staying out late drinking if, I'm not talking about you, but if the shoe fits, Cinderella. What's the culture like in your home? You can't complain about the culture that you set in your own environment. I was complaining about how hot it was in my house, and I forgot that I'm the one who set the thermostat. See, as dads and as fathers, we are to be thermostats and not thermometers. Thermometers will tell you how hot it is in the house. It'll just measure how hot. It'll measure the temperature. But as a thermostat, we set the temperature. We set the standard. We create and we cultivate the atmosphere within our own homes. So today I want to talk to us about raising fathers. I want to talk to us about raising fathers. It's Father's Day. Father's Day message. But this message is for everybody. Just because you're not a father doesn't mean it doesn't pertain to you. Why? Because God is the father to the fatherless. Yes. Moms, I'm pretty sure if you got kids, you're raising fathers. Yeah. Right? This message is for everybody. So today I want to talk to us about raising fathers. What kind of culture are you creating in your own kingdom? What kind of culture are you creating, cultivating in your home? Okay. See, if dad is filled with joy, then the house is filled with joy. Amen. But if dad is short-tempered, short-fused, everybody in the house is walking on eggshells. You ever been in a house where you have to walk on eggshells? Make sure you don't make dad mad. Don't poke the bear. Don't poke the bear. Right? If dad is filled with joy, with peace, with happiness, then the house, the kingdom, is filled with joy, peace, and happiness. That's why I love coming to the house of God. I love being in this house because our Father that we serve is all about joy, peace, and kindness, and love, and mercy. And that's why we need to increase the presence of God in our own homes. Because he is the one true father. Amen? And it's important that we catch this. What we are filled with overflows into the home. As fathers, as dads, if you're filled with complaint, bickering, arguing, anger, then chances are your home is going to be overfilled with anger, bickering, argument, complaints. We need to increase the presence of God in our lives as dads. Now, the title of today's message is Raising Fathers. And the question that I ask is, what does raising fathers look like? What does raising fathers look like? Well, this is what the Lord wrote on my heart. Maybe raising fathers looks like the increasing of their presence. The increase of their presence. Well, maybe you're looking at me and saying, well, also, I'm in my child's life. I haven't left. I'm here. How many of you know that you can be there but not present? I know I was there all 4 years of high school, but I was not present. You can be someplace. You can be there but not present. That's a nice church, but is the presence of God there? You see how important presence is. We can have pictures of Jesus and crosses on the wall. Does not matter if the presence is there. You can have a tool shed in a garage, but if the presence of dad is not there, then what's the sense of the tool shed? Our presence matters. Our presence makes a difference. I'm talking about physical presence and spiritual presence. Because physical presence takes a toll on our children. Here's some facts. 18.4 million children in the world. 18.4 million children in the world. And one out of every four are without a father figure in the home. This is if you add all it up, out of 18.4 million and one out of every four is without a father in the home, if you add that up, it's enough to fill the state of New York. That's how many kids are out there without a physical dad in the home. And here's some of the things that happen. They're four times greater risk of poverty. They're more likely to have behavioral problems, more likely to go to prison, commit crimes, 7 times more likely to become pregnant as a teen, Studies have shown that dads who are involved in their teenage daughter's lives, she practices more abstinence and safe sex in college. A father who is involved in their teenage daughter's life, it increases the chances of her practicing abstinence and safe sex in college. So the absence of a father is 7 times more likely for them to become pregnant, more likely to face abuse and neglect and abuse of drugs and alcohol and drop out of school. These are some things that I've learned with the physical absence of a father in the home. Dads, can I remind you, I think we've forgotten how important, how powerful your role is in the house. The power of fathers, that the kids, teenage boys, act out less with the dad in the home. How many of you agree with that? Right? Kids, they grow up and they have more long-lasting and satisfying marriages because of the models that mom and dad play in their home. Kids are more likely or less likely to misbehave. Fathers, they benefit from, you benefit becoming a father as well, because when you become a father, your more chance of breaking addictions are higher. Why? Because you want a better life for yourself and for your kids. You break old habits, right? We want to be more responsible as dads, right? A lot of dads, we get healthier. Nobody wants a dad bod. Right? A lot of dads, they'll try to get healthy. Why? For the sake of their kids. They want to see their kids grow up, graduate, get married. They want to see all that. So the power of becoming a father, the power of being a father is still there. I think we've just forgotten the importance of our role. And that's why today I want to encourage us and I want to remind us as dads how impactful your life is on your family, on your wife, on your kids. What about the dads who don't get to live with their kids? Well, studies have shown that these benefits still reach them as long as you try to make an effort in involving yourself in their lives. So this message is for everybody. I want to talk about raising fathers. Why? Because you have an impact on the generations to come. Now, when I was preparing for this message, the Lord had reminded me of a story of a king in the Bible in 2 Kings. He goes by the name of Jehoiakim, with an N, Jehoiakim. He was the son of Jehoiakim with an M. Weird Bible names. Crazy. But this king, Jehoiakim, was not a good king. As a matter of fact, the word of God says it this way in 2 Kings 24:9. Jehoiakim did what was evil in the Lord's sight, just as his father had done. There was an influence. See, Jehoiakim's dad, Jehoiakim, did what was evil in the sight of the Lord. And he followed his influence. He followed his footsteps. But what was interesting to me is that his grandfather was Josiah, another king. And Josiah was a good king. Josiah was a good king. It says it here in 2 Kings 22:2, Josiah, and he did what was right in the sight of the Lord and walked in all the ways of his father David. Now, this is what the Lord spoke to me. See, Josiah's dad wasn't physically David. Josiah's dad was Ammon, was King Ammon, and his grandfather was Manasseh. They both were evil kings. But it's interesting to me that Josiah followed the footsteps of his ancestor David. They called him his father David because it's like, you know, when you hear people say, my forefathers, the people that came before me, my ancestors. So Josiah came from a line of evil kings, yet he followed the right influence. This taught me that no matter what your family history looks like, there's an example to follow in being a father. It doesn't matter what your family history or the generational curses look like, there is an example to follow. You have a choice to follow either the father of Jehoiakim, who was an evil king, or you have the choice of following King David, who was a good king in the Lord's eyes. You have a choice. No matter what your family history looks like, no matter what your dad or your granddad did, you have an example to follow, which is in Christ. And today I want to take us back to the Word of God. I'm not going to do a lot of preaching today, but I'm going to do a lot of teaching from the Word of God. I want to take it back to the Word of God because that's how important it is. If we want to be better fathers, be better dads, we want to raise our fatherhood, then we got to go back to the Word of God, which brings me to point number one, and it's this. In order to lead the followers, you must first follow the leader. In order to lead the followers, you must first follow the leader. We're here to break generational curses. We're here to break generational curses and set up generational blessings. We're here to break generational curses and set up generational blessings. If we want to set up generational blessings for our kids and our kids to come, then we need to learn to follow the leader. I wrote in my notes, there are two lies that the enemy will tell a father, will tell a man in the house. And one of the lies is this, that there is no instruction manual to follow fatherhood. The enemy will lie to you and say there is no instruction manual to becoming a father. And then the enemy will also lie and say there is no right or wrong way of being a father. Can I encourage you? There is an instruction manual to becoming a father. There is a right way. There's only the way to becoming a father. You want an example to follow? We serve the Father who loves us so much that he sent his only son to die for us. We serve the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. If there is an example that you ought to set for yourself as a father in a home, learn from the Word of God. Learn from Jesus himself. Learn from God who is our Father. He's a good, good Father, a faithful God. If you want to lead the followers, you want to lead your kids, you want to lead your children, you want to lead your wife, then we got to learn on how Jesus led. Learn how God loves. Learn how God led the people. Amen? Maybe you forgot how important your role is, dads. Maybe you forgot how important and how impactful your life is in the house. Let me remind you with this scripture in Ephesians 5:23. For a husband is the head of his wife, as Christ is the head of the church. He is the savior of his body, the church. Husbands, you are the head of your wife, just as Christ is head of the church. Now, I did some studies for us because this was very, very powerful scripture. I did some studies. I did some research. I went on Google. I went on Blue Letter Bible. I went in the dictionary, Webster, all that stuff, Siri. I asked everybody. I did all this research. And I wanted to explain how powerful this phrase is in the scripture. The phrase, just as, I want you to write this down because this is very important. Just as means the same. Just as means the same. Equivalent. Fathers, husbands, you are the head of your wife. You're the head of your house, just like Christ is the head of this house. It's the same way. The way Jesus leads his people, the way Jesus loves his people, the way Jesus cares for the sheep is the same way you ought to love your family, the same way that you ought to care for your kids. It's the same way. It's the same thing. Just as Christ loves the church, just as Christ is the head of the church. We have an example to follow. So I don't want to hear the baloney. I don't want to hear the balogna. That I wasn't given an instruction manual on how to be a dad. I don't want to hear it. There is an example that Jesus came and he set for us. He came and he said he was the example. He is the example. So go back to the Word of God. Amen? Because I've learned that the teacher will not give you a test without the materials to study. A teacher will not test you on things that he hasn't taught you. Teacher will not test you on material that he has not given you. We have the material. It's in black and white right in our hands. Some of it is sitting on our nightstand desk. Some of it got a little more cobwebs than other. Some of it got a little more dust than other. Pick up the Bible and read the Bible. You know what the best Bible is? It's a red Bible. And I'm not talking about color. The best Bible is a red Bible. And it's not about the color. It's a Bible that's being opened, that's being used, that's being applied to their lives. Amen. Fathers, husbands, we got to get back to the Word of God. You want to raise your fatherhood? You want to be better at being a dad, being a husband? Then let's go back to the Word of God. Now I want to address the kids. I want to talk about the kids for a little bit. Can we talk about the kids? Because I got two of them at home. And boy, let me tell you, having two, that must have been God's plan because it was not ours. Having two kids, right? Proverbs 22:6 says this, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Fathers, we have a huge influential, impactful role in the house. The spiritual umbrella goes God, husbands, wives, children. We ought to lead our families. Train up the children in the way of the Lord. When they get older, they do not depart from it. See, when Jesus was with the disciples, he knew his time frame. He knew that he didn't have all the time to be here. So he had to train them up, teach them, because he knew he wasn't going to be with them forever. Remember, we got to follow the example of Jesus and how he loved and cared for the church. In our kids, we have to do our best to pour into them, because knowing and understanding that we're not going to be here forever. As fathers, as husbands, we're not going to be here forever. So I'm going to do my absolute best to pour all that I can into my children, godly principles, godly values, so that when they get older and dad's no longer here, they still live Christ-like. We have an example to follow. It's in the Word of God. It's in the Word of God. We have to train them up in the way of the Lord. We have to train up our children. See, my dad didn't train me to be him. He trained me to be like him. I could never be my dad. But he poured into me enough to where people say, oh, you're Daniel's son. Because they know me. They know my dad, and they see the characteristics of my life and some of the things I say, some of the things I do, and they say, you're Daniel's son. Why? Because I spent time with him. I know him. I love him. The more time you spend with Christ, the more time you spend with Jesus, the more and more you start to look like him, and then it trickles down into your children, the more and more they look like Christ because you look like Christ. It's a domino effect, but dads, it starts with us. Why? Because we're the head of the house. We're the head of the house. It starts with us. Now I want to address the kids in this area. Proverbs 13, 24. Woo! Parents, love this one. Those who spare the rod of discipline hate their children. Those who love their children care enough to discipline them. All the parents say, we need discipline, man. We need discipline. We need discipline. If you don't think you need discipline, as a child of God, I know I need discipline. I know I need discipline. Now, however you discipline your kids, that's between you and your kids. That's between you and God. I know I grew up a little different from other people. I grew up a little different from other people. We had old school discipline. Old school discipline. Now, people would ask me, do you hate your dad because of the way he disciplined you? I said, no, I thank God my dad disciplined me. I thank God he disciplined me. Why? Because I knew that if he didn't discipline me, it could have got worse. You ever see the guardrails on the side of the freeway? You ever see a car driving up again? It's scraping. It's ugly. It sounds horrible. That's what spanking looks like. That's what discipline looks like. But you know that the guardrail is to keep you from falling off the edge. Sometimes you need the guardrail. Sometimes you need the discipline. Sometimes you need it so you don't fall off the edge. Now how you discipline your kids is between you and the authorities. I'm not here to tell you how to discipline your kids. But nonetheless, we do need discipline. Well, we need discipline. Even God says it himself in the Word. I'm not just saying this speaking from me. No, I'm speaking from the Word of God. He said, if you love your kids, you will discipline them. Amen. Why? Because they're a reflection of who you are out in the world. Right. I tell people all the time, when you become a Christian, you carry the name of Christ. Right. You adopt that name. Amen. When you're walking around, people are seeing the Christ in you. Just like my kids, I pray that when they're out in the world and when dad's not around, I pray that they're behaving themselves. Why? Because they know that's Austin's kids. And I pray that they don't give me a bad rap. How many know people who are Christians that give God a bad rap? Right? We gotta accept the discipline when God disciplines us and says, hey, what you're doing is bad. Don't do that. We need discipline. It's for his glory. It's to glorify him. Go back to the Word of God. Go back to it. Now, we could spend hours in the book of Proverbs on how to be better fathers and all this stuff, but I've only got three. So let's move on. In order to lead the fathers, my first follow leader. Second thing is this: husbands, love your wife. All the women in the house say,
amen.
Husbands, love your wife. Trust me, guys, it was hard for me to write this message too. Love your wife. Love your wife. Don't get mad at me, husbands. Don't get mad at me, guys. It's biblical. It's in the Word. It says in Ephesians 5, 25 and 26, it says, husbands, love your wives. Listen. Just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, and he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the Word. Love your wife just as, remember our Bible study? Just as means the same. How Christ loves the church, we ought to love our wives. What did Christ do for the church? He gave himself for the church. He died for the church, laid himself down for the church, put aside his selfish wants and desires for the church, long-suffering for the church. Fellas, we got to love our wives. We got to love our wives. Now, guys, I know sometimes it's hard for us to be vulnerable and to open up and to share and to show that we're weak. So sometimes we'll go off and we'll just kind of pray to God on our own. And you get a little soft and you start to get a little watery-eyed and you start to cry before the Lord and you start to weep and you just pour out to God. And it's so amazing when God, he just gives you an open ear and he's slow to speak and he's just opening up his heart and listening to his child cry. What if we were to do the same with our wives? See, sometimes our wives just want to come to us and cry and pour and vent and let it all out. But how many times, fellas, do we turn it into a life lesson or a teaching? You know what? You know what your problem is? Sit down, let me tell you. I'll tell you what your problem is. We flip it on the wife. When all she wants is just someone to open up their heart, open up their ear, just be an ear for me to cry and to vent to. Jesus did it for us. He does it for us on a daily. Husbands, we ought to extend the same grace that we are given. Extend the same love that we are given. Love your wife just as Christ love the church. What does that look like? What are some other practical things? How about actually paying attention when she's talking to you? I know I'm guilty. How many times I'm yep, uh-huh, yeah. Okay, Austin, what did I say? What? Right? Or man, the game's on. Boston is playing the Warriors. It's game 6. And all of a sudden, she wants to sit down and talk. All of a sudden, she wants to sit down in front of the TV. Hey, can we talk? Christ put away his selfish wants and his desires to love the church. So husbands, we put away our selfish desires to love our wife. We got to love our wives. The greatest gift you can give your kids is loving on your wife. When you love their mother, that's the greatest gift you can give them. When they see dad act like a gentleman to the mom, you're not only just teaching them, but you're showing them what real love looks like. How a dad or a husband will talk to the wife. The kids are watching. Kids will follow what you do and not what you say. And many times my son acts, you know, he's still learning, he don't know how to talk or how to act sometimes, and he'll raise his voice to my wife. You know, I'm like, hey, Axe, don't talk to mom like that. And he'll, oh, okay. I remember one time my wife and I, we were getting a little argument, and the voices got loud. My son came out the room, hey, daddy, don't talk to mom like that. But I'm glad he did that, because it's what I taught him. I said, oh, I got you, son. But they will follow what you do and not what you say. You can tell them not to do something all you want, but if you're still doing it, you got to lead by example. So love your wife. You want them to respect mom, then you respect your wife. You want them to honor mom, then honor your wife. Amen? I remember one time the pastor was sharing a message, and I was in the back with my wife, and we were listening, and the pastor used the same scripture. And at the end of the scripture, it says, to wash her with the word of God. I was like, wow, that's so powerful. I leaned over, and I put my arm around my wife, and I said, babe, Proverbs 26:11. She was like, oh, my gosh. What does it say? And I said, a fool returns to its sin like a dog returns to its vomit. She was like, what? I said, my bad, I meant Psalms. I meant that you are fearfully and wonderfully made. That's what I meant to say. Husbands, wash your wife with the word of God. Love on her When she's having a bad day, sometimes she just wants an ear. Sometimes she just wants to vent. Wash her with the word of God. Hey, God can do all things, baby. It's going to be all right. The bills are going to get paid. It's going to be all right. God is faithful. Speak those kind of things over your wife. Love on her. Be an example for the kids as well. Amen? But wait. Next bullet point. But wait. Wives, submit to your husbands. All the brothers in the house say. Hold on, Pastor Austin. I thought this was a Father's Day message. Why are you coming after the women? There's a reason. There's a reason. I'm not just picking on you. There's a reason. And it's found in the Word of God in 1 Peter 3:1. It says, wives, likewise, be submissive to your own husbands, that even if some do not obey the word, they, without a word, may be won by the conduct of their wives. The way you live your life, the way you submit to your husband, could be the very thing that helps him get to that breakthrough. Your conduct, the way you live your, the way you love and the way that you respect and honor your husband. Sometimes words won't do it, but your life will. So wives, submit to your husbands. That even if they don't believe, even if they have a hard time, they're going through a season, they're going through a situation or a circumstance, love them, respect them, honor them, submit to them, because your conduct could be the very thing that sets them free. And I wanted to share a couple of statistics that I've learned, because there's a silent epidemic. There's a silent assassin in the world right now that's been killing males, fathers in the home. The enemy wants to remove the father. Smite the shepherd and the sheep scatter. There's been a silent epidemic killing males, and it's not diseases, it's not cancer, it's none of that. What's been killing the males in the home is suicide. It's been suicide. Male suicide rates are on the rise and increasing. Men die by suicide 3.53 times more often than women. Every day, 123 men in the U.S. alone die from suicide, 84 in the U.K. So can I speak on behalf of the men and the husbands here in the room to the wives? Sometimes all we want is a cheerleader and not a coach. Sometimes all we need is a cheerleader and not a coach. You see, the coach will say, you didn't do this right, you forgot to do this, you messed up here, you need to get better at this. That's a coach. But a cheerleader is, hey, we appreciate you for what you're doing. Even in your mistakes, even when you mess up, thank you for what you're doing. Hey, we love you. Me and the kids, we're here for you. Sometimes as a husband, we go through so much pressure being a husband, being a father. The world teaches us that we got to be the breadwinner. The world has taught us all these things, and then all this pressure is on the males, on the husbands of the household. And the enemy uses that to destroy families, to take out the dad. Because of all this pressure, you know how you could relieve the pressure, wives? Submit to your husband. Just love him. Be his biggest cheerleader. Be his biggest supporter. I'm talking about being like his biggest cheerleader. Like, hey, Mickey, you're so fine. You're so fine. You blow my mind. Hey, Mickey. Hey, Mickey. You want to be his biggest cheerleader. You want to be his, I'm talking about like varsity, Letterman's jacket, wearing like cheerleader, boy, girlfriend and boyfriend. Like, you got to be his biggest support system. Here's why. Because there's another cheerleader on JV waiting for her opportunity. If you won't support your husband, someone on JV wants to. She goes by the name of Delilah. And she a Delilah. She's waiting for her opportunity. She said, you don't want to support your husband? I will. You don't want to love on your husband? I will. You don't want to raise up your husband? I will. There's a cheerleader on JV waiting for her opportunity at the top of the pyramid. You got to raise up the husband and the father of the home by submitting to him and honoring and respecting him. Sometimes the dads, the husbands, all we want is a cheerleader, someone to just support us. Do we make mistakes? Absolutely. Are we perfect? No. But one of my favorite prophets, Denzel Washington, he said, progress over perfection. Amen. As long as you're making an effort, dads, just try. Suicide's not something to laugh about. I wanted to throw a little humor in there, but suicide is something to take seriously. Dads, if you're going through, man, you're just struggling with mental issues, mental health, reach out to somebody. We're here for you. We love you guys. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And the last thing is this, number three. The life you live now impacts the lives to come after. The life you live now impacts the lives to come after. I've learned a lot in my short time of being a dad. My son Axe is going to be 4 next month. My son Praise, he just turned 2. So in my short time, man, I've learned a lot in what it takes to be a dad, and I'm still learning, still growing. But I've appreciated and I've loved the journey. I've grown. I've had my wins. I've had my losses. You know, I've had my ups. I have my downs. But nonetheless, I'm thankful that I had an example to follow the Word of God and how Jesus and how God never gave up on us, was relentless after his children, persevered. And I've learned all that from the Word of God. And it was such an honor for me to be a dad. And Axe, this guy, every year on his birthday, I tell him the same thing. You know, a lot of parents, they'll post pictures on social media and stuff. And I always say this. I said, Axe, I'm still learning to be your dad, but you've already mastered being my son. He's done such an amazing job at bringing joy to the house, and we're always laughing. And this guy, he's learned so much that he's become too smart for his own good. He has managed to figure out our Amazon account. If you guys know my son, Axe, he loves worship. He loves Uncle Lucas, who plays the electric guitar. Everything Lucas does, he copies. Everything Lucas does, he follows. Lucas wears his hat backwards, he wears a hat backwards. Lucas had a computer, he wanted a computer. Good thing we had like an old broken one that he doesn't know it's broken. We set that thing up and he said, oh yeah, let's play guitar. Right? He loves worship. But he's figured out our Amazon account to where now he's purchasing worship items. This guy bought himself a mic stand. I'm not talking about like the Fisher Price children's mic. He bought a real mic stand. It was like 35, like 40 bucks. I was like, man, that's my money. And then he bought himself a guitar stand to put his guitar. It's toy guitars, but he bought a real guitar stand. And I think it was like 20, 25 bucks. He's figuring it out. My son loves to worship, and I thank God that I get to witness. Sometimes he'll come with us on Tuesdays, and he'll worship with the team. But it's such a joy to know that my son is falling in love with worship. And it wasn't by my force. I didn't force him to learn an instrument. I didn't force him to want to worship. He just did it because he's seen dad do it. Amen. And it reminds me of when my dad first started coming to New Hope. My dad found New Hope Las Vegas. The rest of the family, we were kind of still in the world. We were like, we're good. So my dad would come to church like every Sunday, and he would ask us, hey, you guys want to come to church? And I remember multiple times where I was like, I'm good. I would stay home, sleep in, watch football, just hang out. I didn't want to come to church. But I started to see a change in my dad. I started to see this gradual change and something different in my dad. And I wanted to know who this Jesus was that he was going to see every Sunday. So I started to come to church. But it was not by his force. It was because I was influenced by it and I wanted to learn. And thank God I did, because I started to follow and I started to listen to the word. I started to serve. I got involved. I'm on the worship team, and I truly believe that my son was impacted by that. And I thank God that I get to witness him worship. And I wanted to share with us today just a little snippet of our home life and how Axe worships at home. So if we could cue that video of Axe. Isn't he awesome? Look, he wanted to finish the chorus.
Oh my God, you are
And we caught him worshiping one night. This is a video of him just worshiping. If you listen closely, I'm speaking in the background because this was one of our worship sets. And he was just worshiping. And my wife and I caught it. We didn't know what he was doing. We thought this was so precious. But this didn't happen just overnight. This didn't happen just out of the blue. I truly believe it started from the life that my dad lived that impacted the lives that came after. This is, that's me, and this is my dad. You see, the life that you live now impacts the lives to come after. In our final scripture for today, a righteous man who walks in his integrity, how blessed are his sons after him. See, did my dad know that we were going to have a son by the name of Axe who loved guitar and loved worship? No, he didn't know that. But it was just the life that he lived. He didn't know. So that's why I'm here to encourage and to tell you, dads, that the life you live now impacts the lives to come after you. Train up your kids in the way of them. Maybe worship's not your thing. Serve. Get involved in the church. Let them see you make godly decisions. Let them see you get involved in the church. Train them up in the way of the Lord so that when they depart, they do not grow old from it. I pray that after my life, Axe and his sons are worshiping. You know, I pray that him and his sons are serving someplace in the house of God. Because Joshua said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. So dads, I challenge you. I encourage you, men, husbands. There's an example that we have. You want to lead the followers? Then first learn to follow the leader. Secondly, love your wives. Wives, submit to your husbands. And know that the life that you live now has an impact for the lives to come after. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. How many received that word today? Amen, amen. Could you join me as we pray? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this word and for this reminder to all the dads and how important and influential our roles are in the house. Lord, if we want to make home improvements, Father, it starts with us. So, Lord, I just pray for every dad that's in this house. May your love, your grace, and your mercy cover them. Lord, we thank you for the word and the reminder and the encouragement. May you continue to teach us from your word. For your example is the only example, Father God, and it's the only way. So, Lord, bless this time. Bless people are here, people are online, and continue to watch over us today. We give you the praise and the glory. In Jesus' name we say, amen. Amen.
You will be my light, even when I'm hopeless. You will be my light.
together.
Hallelujah. Can we give it up for the Hula team, the Creative Arts Ministry? Amen. Wasn't that a powerful special? Happy Father's Day to all the dads in the house. Amen. Come on, can we get up for the dads in the house? Amen, amen. How many received the word today? Well, today I didn't want to send you guys off, especially the dads, without giving you guys a gift. First, the gift of prayer. Amen. So if I could ask all the dads in the house to come to the altar. We want to pray for you. I feel like it's important. Dads, could we get all the dads in the house, all the fathers in the house? Come on, let's give it up for all the fathers. We can make way to the altar. There's a lot of dads in the second service, so let's make room. Amen, amen. All the fathers, hallelujah. Look at all the mighty men of God. Mighty men of God. Amen, amen, amen. The word of God says that your children are like arrows in your hands. Men, you are warriors. I know every day it's a battle. Every day you're going through a battle. I pray that the word of God be the only thing that you run to. We've given out a ticket to all the dads because I not only want to pray for you, but we also want to feed you. Huh, dads? How's that sound? We got lunch for you provided out in the foyer. We wanted to bless the dads. So after this service, go outside and give them the ticket so that you can redeem your lunch. We want to bless you with some physical food, but also spiritual food. And I want to pray for you today. Dads, can I just see your eyes for a second? I'm looking into the eyes of God's warriors. That his children are like arrows in his hands. Dads, I thank you. From the bottom of my heart, on behalf of New Hope Las Vegas, we want to thank you, dads. We know how important the role of a father is in the house. We also know the pressures that come with it. By the grace of God, you are standing here with your head held high, chin up, knowing that no matter what the enemy throws your way, you will lay your life down for your family because that's how Christ did for the church. Dads, I thank you and we love you. Thank you for being awesome. Thank you for being you. We're not looking for perfection, we're looking for progress. So we thank you, dads, for just waking up and being present in your children's lives, being present in the house. Right now, I want to pray for you. Dads, if you could just stretch forth your hands. And congregation, if you could stretch forth your hands towards the dads, I want to pray. Dads, receive this prayer wholeheartedly. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, right now for every dad that is at the altar right now, Father. Lord, only you know the battles that they go through, Father. Only you know the pressures that they feel, Lord. And I pray right now, Father God, that you equip them, Lord God. I pray that you bring peace. I pray that you bring strength, Father God. I pray, Lord, that you be the one to walk alongside them, Father. I thank you for these mighty men of God, Lord, that come and to seek you, Father. I pray right now, Father, whatever they're facing, whatever they're going through, Lord, may they lay it at the altar to die at the altar. Father, we thank you that we have a God who is the example setter. We have a God who is a redeemer, a restorer of homes. So, Lord, I pray right now for restoration in the home, Lord God. I don't know who this prayer is for, Lord, but I feel like there has been a home that's been divided by offense, a home that's been hurt, a home that's going through some marriage issues right now, Father. I bind that up and I cast it as far as it is from the east to the west. Lord, I pray for restoration in marriages. I pray for restoration between husband and wife. I pray for restoration between the children and their father. I pray, Lord God, that the respect and the honor come back into the home as they respect and honor dad, Lord God. I pray right now in the name of Jesus, Lord. You are the redeemer, Lord God, of our paths, Lord God. We thank you, Lord, that our past does not define who we are as dads and as fathers. But, Lord, you have called us You have called us as your children, Lord God. You've called us as your sons and your daughters, Father. So right now, I lift up every dad that is here. May their shoulders be strengthened in the name of Jesus. That you don't remove the cross, but you strengthen their shoulders to carry it. Because they are mighty, mighty men. So, Lord, let today be a celebration of the dads in our homes. And, Father, right now we lift up for those who have lost their fathers. We also lift up those who have lost their fathers, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you are the father to the fatherless. Lord, we declare and we are going to break the curse of fatherlessness in America. And we're going to break that curse, Lord God. Break generational curses. And we're going to set up generational blessings, Father. And we thank you for the dads. May you bless them, keep them, love on them, shine your mercy and your grace on them. As they go on about their days, Lord, may they be loved, respected, and honored. We love you, Lord. We give you the praise and the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Dads, we love you guys. Thank you guys so much. New Hope, how many received the word again? Good. Hey, if you need prayer, we have our prayer team to the left and to the right. May God bless you. God keep you. Happy Father's Day, and we'll see you next week.
Thank you for joining us. Tune in next week on Wednesday evening at 7 p.m. And next Sunday, for you early birds, we are going to be streaming at 8 a.m., 10 a.m., and then again at 12 p.m. For more information and to stay connected to our church family, download our New Hope LV app. Or you can visit our website at newhopelasvegas.com. May God bless you and God prosper you. We can't wait to see you again. In the meantime, keep hope alive.